Now, we did, you did have a breach on the list of coverage, and this one is actually pretty big. We've had some big breaches that we've talked about over the past few months, but this one is right up there too. It makes me happy that, you know, our IT security guys are on top of things here at F5.
Yeah, it's breaches are a big problem and will continue to be, don't get me wrong. We've seen, I don't know, a continual stream of massive breaches of people's personal data over the last several years. This one is different because it was actually a breach of corporate intellectual property, so code, libraries, that kind of thing. Dropbox, relatively recently, were breached by a MFA bypass campaign. So it was a phishing campaign impersonating CircleCI, harvesting credentials, and then gaining access to the victim org. That was actually came up in September, that was warned about by GitHub, and clearly in October, Dropbox found themselves victim of that. The good thing as a user of Dropbox, I guess, is that no user data, as far as we know, was breached directly. But per Dropbox's disclosure, some third-party libraries that Dropbox have modified for their own use, or in internal prototypes and tools and configuration files used, ironically, I'll add that bit there, by the security team, were breached. Now, I guess the risk is always that you go from breaching code to finding a way to breach data. That's an aim of breaching code. But this is the latest in what's becoming a sort of pandemic, to use a word that I hate, of MFA bypass attacks, right? They're becoming really prevalent now. And I think as MFA has been increasingly adopted, especially corporate systems and almost everywhere else supports MFA now, attackers had to find ways to bypass it, whether that was, you know, MFA bombing or really advanced phishing campaigns.
Mm-hmm. I'm fascinated by how linear that progression was. Mm-hmm. Right, in the past, often we've seen the industry strongly advocate for a particular security control, and people have implemented it, and then attackers have had to shift tactics away from that particular technology. Mm-hmm. In this case, we've known phishing has been a problem for years, and MFA is a great security addition to that flow. I'm not going to say it's a fix, but it's, you know, it's an important thing to have. We advocated for that strongly. People actually implemented it, and then attackers just went ahead and bypassed it, right? Or mm-hmm. found techniques, right? So clearly, there's value in that particular flow for attackers. Like, it is worth not just jumping over to something else, but like continuing to bang, you know, to be dedicated to that flow. And I have to just say, this seems to be, to me, to be an indication of just how effective phishing actually is, right? That it's worth trying to circumvent that control, as opposed to, you know, going and doing something easier, right?
It also, I mean, on the one hand, you could kind of look at how quickly this has turned around and say that it's kind of a sign of how successful MFA has been, because there's also clearly been the sort of attention put into this problem of bypassing it, right? And mm-hmm. so I sort of always end up at a lot of disease metaphors when I'm thinking about security. And so it's one of these things where it's like, if you are recommending a medication or you're recommending a fix, you kind of already have to start thinking ahead to what happens when whoever I'm fighting adapts to the fix that I'm bringing out, right? So the minute you start recommending a fix, you should probably start also thinking, what's the next generation thing? What is the next phase of auth or MFA look like? Because I sort of felt like it was inevitable that we arrive at this point. And at the same time, I would still recommend everybody implement MFA for now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? It's still the best thing we got, but it's remarkable how quickly we've gone to, hey, I think I'm hearing a little bit about MFA bypass, and now it's week in, week out, right?
Mm-hmm. It's intriguing. We had a couple of customers when I was still doing sales that were very much on board with MFA early, probably mm-hmm. somewhere in like 2010, 2011. These guys were in upstate too. So I imagine in big cities, they were doing it even more already. But these, I saw many instances of 3 and 4 factor authentication early with these, you know, these other, you know, some of the places that I consider to be fairly intelligent, where you're not just doing, you know, a login and a captcha, you know, you're doing a login, a second factor, you know, via token. And then you got another thing that's like, you know, machine key or something like that, a pre-shared key, on and on, you know, or the other one that was really common was Windows registry keys. I loved seeing that, or hidden files on any sort of corporate Macs. There are ways to go to multi, and I hope, you know, I hope F5 customers out there or anyone out there is hearing this. There is more to multi-factor than simply, you know, just the usual suspects. You can get creative with that. And of course, if you need help with that, you can always ask your F5 field SE. Shameless plug.
that I think is a really good point. You know, I think that the typical understanding of MFA is that I have to type in a code from an authenticator app or maybe do some kind of SMS thing. Not a huge fan of the SMS thing. But you're absolutely right. You know, at least in some scenarios where there's a greater degree of control over the device that you're and the whole chain of those things, companies can implement device level certificates. There can be user level certificates. There can be behavioral zero trusty kind of, you know, patterns to be brought in. You know, is this person logging in from an identifiably corporate laptop using software that is what we expect them to be using from a location at a time that we expect them to be doing so? You know, it's, you can really start layering things on, and that's significantly better. I'm not sure how that applies to, you know, my Google account or something like that, but hopefully we'll see maybe a little bit more development. But you know, obviously you have to balance privacy and ease of use against these things.
Now, Aaron, do I understand this one correctly, that even if Dropbox had been using a hardware token like a YubiKey or something, this specific bypass technique would have still captured that token string and succeeded, right?
I think so, yeah. It's funny that you mentioned YubiKey and other stuff. I was just thinking, actually going back to the SMS as the second factor, Malcolm, you said you dislike SMS as the second factor, SIM swapping attacks, that kind of thing.
Yeah, not a huge fan. It's been bypassed a bunch.
Yeah.
What I seem to have, I don't know why it's suddenly become common. Maybe it's the sites that I've been going to. Sounds bad. Or maybe it's been a shift, but email is the second factor, which seems even worse.
Yeah. Not a huge fan of that either. Yeah.
You know, if SMS is bad, email's got to be worse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. Wow. Yeah, let's rely on something super trustworthy like SMTP.
Mm. Yeah.
It isn't even so much the protocol. It's just, email compromise is such a huge issue, right? And has been for so very, very long.
Yeah.
You know, even without going into two-factor things, I mean, it's absurd to me in some ways that you have situations where you might have multi-factor authentication to be able to log in. But to reset your password, you just need access to somebody's email account.